from plants that use clones, spores, and seeds, to ones that employ colours, scents, and shapes to attract or trick animals, Flora has all sorts of ways to get freaky and reproduce. Hey, I'm Vanessa Fuchs, and in today's episode of What the Flora, we're going to explore the wonderful world of plant love. We're inside the Royal Botanic Garden Sydney at the latest immersive horticultural exhibition at the Calyx. It's called Love Your Nature, and there's over 20,000 plants on display, all about showcasing and celebrating the wonderful world of plant reproduction. In today's episode, we're going to have a chat to scientist Lily Dunn and horticulturist Terra-Nova about some of the best plants on display, plant reproduction, and the science that goes into saving them. While you're watching today's episode, just leave your questions in the comments and we'll have one of our experts get back to you. All right, well, now we're inside the Calyx at the Love Your Nature exhibition, and I'm joined by Terra-Nova. Terra, before we get stuck into this amazing display, just tell us a little bit about yourself and your role here at the Royal Botanic Garden Sydney.
Yeah, well, my role is just working in this space, in the Calyx. I look after the green wall behind you, and I help manage the space in terms of when we turn it into an event venue, and also horticulturally, all of the plants in here, all of the design as it comes in and out every year, and we change it.
So how many plants are there here on display? Because there are a lot, right?
I can't tell you how many plants are in the individual beds, but the wall is made up of over 18,000 individual potted plants.
Oh my goodness. And so what does it take to care for them? I mean, I'm feeling a slight sort of temperature difference in here from outside. So yeah, what are some of those tips and tricks?
So this is a really tricky space because it functions as both an event space and a horticultural space. So in terms of the plants, it's quite a challenge because we've got to keep the temperature in here. Even though it looks like a greenhouse, we've got to keep the temperature okay for the humans. We actually can't use a lot of misters or things like that for the humidity because there's televisions and electronics and things like that that will go on the fritz if we use that. So we've really got to pick the plants well that will do okay in the conditions that they're given, and we've got to watch the plants and replace them as need be because they're inside for an entire year.
And how do you water them? I mean, we're looking at a vertical wall here. It's 50 meters long. I mean, it's huge. Yeah. You'd need more than a ladder and a hose, right?
So the plants in the wall are on an irrigation system. The water basically trickles behind the pots and fills up underneath them. And so they're watered from the bottom up, and then it drains down and down and down. And it's actually a really good way to water plants because they only take up the water that they need. And you'd be surprised how little water we use in a week. I think each plant takes up less than 300 or 400 mL.
Wow.
Yeah. So we're actually experimenting now with introducing that system into the bed display as well. So wicking the water from the bottom up to try and save and conserve water.
So just on that green wall, because it is, you know, the largest in the southern hemisphere of its kind, it's definitely, you know, the main backdrop. What type of plants are in there and how do you actually make the display come to life?
So this wall is only one plant, if you can believe that. It's just different varieties of the same plant. It's heuchera. And heuchera is perfect for this display because it comes in so many different colors and they don't get very big, so they don't shade out the plants around them. And they don't require any cutting back. So it's just a foliage plant. And so we're able to really use the wall as sort of paint by numbers, if you will. And the point of this display was to really introduce a lot of color. So the wall, we started with the wall design, and then the rest of the theme kind of came off of that.
Yeah, what is the theme though? It's Love Your Nature, it's very colourful, but tell us a little bit about the backstory to that and what it's supposed to be all about.
So the display is called Love Your Nature, and it's a celebration of the diversity of plants and specifically the diversity of the reproductive characteristics of plants. And it's meant to coincide with World Pride, which is happening in Sydney in February and March next year, 2023. And that's a huge deal for the city of Sydney. I think it's one of the biggest events that we've hosted since the Olympics. So that's kind of where the idea came from, to celebrate diversity through the plant world, because there's really no such thing as normal when it comes to plants and how they've been reproducing and evolving throughout time. So each of these beds represents a different ecosystem that plants can thrive in their own individual environments, and all of the stories kind of talk about all of the different ways that plants reproduce.
What are some of the ways? I mean, people I think might think of pollen and bees, but there's so much more. Do you want to highlight maybe one of your favorites?
I think one of the main things that a lot of people have noticed in this display so far is that most of the flowers that you see that we're automatically drawn to are actually hermaphroditic. So they've got male and female parts both in the flower. It's more the norm to have that than to have a plant be dioecious, which is to have a male and a female components separate on the flowers.
Wow. So
that's kind of you'll kind of see a journey as you go through. There's also really cool bed that's a conservation bed. So that bed talks about how humans have been propagating plants and our interactions with the plants, how we depend on them for so many things, how we actually, started civilizations around grains and grasses and things like that. So I think it's got a really cool story about the future of humans and plants as well.
And so what are the different garden bed themes? You've touched on it, but if you just sort of highlight, what people can expect to see in each one of those.
So the first bed is the ancient bed, and that highlights a lot of the gymnosperms, mosses, lichens, things with not complex reproductive strategies. And then as you go on, you'll start to see a little bit more color introduced into the palette because, back in the day, in the Cretaceous or, really, 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 really long time ago, there weren't as many insects pollinating the plants. So they didn't have to be colorful to attract them. They depended on wind and water and things like that to move the seeds around. So as insects came on the scene, they started to introduce more complex flowers, more color, and you'll see that in the tropical bed and the orchid bed behind me. And then we've got our seasonal beds in the middle. So these beds are kind of cool because we can move them around and use the space as an event venue. And we're going to be changing out those beds every few months. So there'll be every season that comes around, we'll be putting new plants in. So I think that's there's kind of a lesson in that about, the ephemerality of a lot of these flowers and the fact that you can come back and see something different every time. And then after that, we've got the ARID bed. So there are a lot of the stories in that bed are about, plants that are, they're survivors and they're very tenacious. They're very resourceful. You can break a leaf off and it'll just grow roots from that. And then we've got the conservation bed, which has a lot of really good stories about how, even in the face of climate change, people are using technologies to propagate these plants and keep them alive and keep that lineage going. Even with the challenges that we face environmentally.
And so this display is going to be going actually for 2 years. Normally it's 1 year. And so how is it going to change? Will it change at all? Or like you said, the plants in the wall, they're kind of you know, they don't grow too big and don't need trimming, but what can people expect to see?
So there's a lot of work that goes into keeping the display looking good. I think a lot of people will come here and they'll say, oh, wow, how do you grow that inside? I can't do that. And, well, really, it only lasts a few months and we have to replace them. So the whole wall is actually going to be replaced, but we are putting in a new design. So that's how we're keeping it fresh throughout those 2 years. We've got a new design in the wall. We've got the seasonal beds. And as we discover what works well in this space and what people are attracted to, we're going to be switching out things and plants and stories in the side beds as well.
I think people are so interested in the horticultural side of things. They get inspired when they come here. You mentioned once before that, you know, it's so stunning. It looks like there's nothing out of place, that you go around with little tweezers sometimes. Can you tell us a bit about that?
Just in the beginning, before the plants get away from me, we really try to, make the space as perfect as possible. This is sort of our horticultural jewel in the crown, if you will. So we try to make it look, we have higher standards here for keeping the plants looking good than they might outside.
Oh, yeah. Very fancy.
I like to think so.
Well, thanks so much. We're now going to go to an interview with Lily Dunn, who's in the science team, with James, our other host of What the Flora, take a little bit of a deeper dive into the science behind some of the plants in relation to this display.
Now is a good time to talk a bit about the science. I'm James, I'm in the Calyx at the Royal Botanic Garden Sydney, and we've got people walking around enjoying this incredible display. And right next to me, I have Lily Dunn from the Australian Institute of Botanical Science. So Lily, tell me what you do at the Institute.
Yeah, sure. So I'm a research assistant, and I'm actually at Mount Annan, based in Mount Annan, not here in the city. Wish I was. So what I do is I study the floral traits. So floral traits is anything from like flower colour to flower size to flower sex, and it goes over about 35 traits. So it's a really complex list of things, and all this detailed of the science, all the amazing things that flowers do. And what I'm making is a database of all the traits of one species per genera of Australian angiosperm, which is a flowering plants instead of non-flowering plants.
So this trait database you're creating, Lily, what is the aim of that? What do you want that? What will that be able to do?
Yeah, so it's going to become an open source, completely open source database for any scientists or even anyone to use. So I come from a flower evolution background. So a way to study the evolution of flowers and like the ancestral state, so like the state when they first evolved, is through going through like family trees and working out like, oh, the oldest flowers have these traits, so it probably evolved from that. And then you can start understanding the traits within families and clades, and then it's like, yeah, the whole evolution, and then to when we're kind of like at the end of the tree.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
So how did you get into this?
Yes, sure. So I was actually hired by Austraits, which is it's kind of a new database where they're doing every single trait that you can kind of measure about a plant. So it could be like anything from plant height to like leaf shape, leaf size. And they're trying to create this completely open source database of every single species of Australian plants, so that anyone can use it and trying to understand like the diversity of Australian plants we have over time and space. Yeah.
That's actually really, really interesting. Tell me, do you have a favorite plant and why? what's one of its traits that particularly appeal to you?
Yeah. So I actually grew up in the rainforest of like northern New South Wales. And so my favorite plant, it's a bit of a sentimental one rather than a crazy exciting one. It's called the blue condong, and it's like a massive rainforest plant, and you probably would have seen it has like bright, bright blue berries. And I think, there's something about it, it just grows in the creeks, and it's just like you stare up to it and the line in the creek, and it's just very sentimental value to it.
Sounds awesome. So when it comes to traits and things, what was it that got you into the idea of looking at floral traits in plants?
Yeah. So at the moment, we currently have there's a missing data, like chronically underrepresented of floral traits. While people are always, like scientists are always recording pretty much every other trait, like the amount of traits are on tree height is crazy. And it's really not getting represented, the floral traits, yet they're so fundamental because it is like the reproduction of plants are through the flowers. So we need to understand and start creating databases where the traits are listed. Because most of the, like, when flowers are described, when a plant's first described, they'll do a big description in words of, like, the flower has, like, is this size and has this colour and the ovary is this position. But they won't, like, create a table that anyone can analyse the data. So it's time my role was to go through all the online floras and all the online descriptions, and so I could pull out all that data and turn it into a database that's able to analyse it, so anyone to analyse the data.
So you do think when it comes to looking at traits on plants, the flowers are the best characters. So when you're looking at a flower, would you say that, what would you say are the, what features of a flower are most, could be some key parts to be able to help people identify flowers?
Very hard question. Flowers, like, as you can see, whenever you look at a flower, people honest, I feel like lots of people who don't really think about flowers too much think they're all pretty generic, but it's like they have the bright petals and it's like has usually five or six petals and like that. Whereas I'm looking at orchid right now and you can see it'll be like, what is going on there? So I think it, what to really take away from floral traits is the diversity that occurs. Like no two flowers are ever really the same. And it's just like crazy when you start thinking about the variation that occurs and that people are quite generic when they think of a flower, but when people draw flowers, I'm like, so much more going on.
Exactly. And as we all know from previous, the flora episodes, orchids are an incredible group of plants and very diverse. Mm. Well, thank you, Lily, very much for your time.
Yeah.
We've enjoyed having you.
Thank you.
Well, unfortunately, that's the end of the episode, but we've had so much fun making this and we hope you've enjoyed it as well at home. It was really interesting chat of those two different perspectives. What do you think, James?
Yeah, I thought the horticulture that Terra-Nova was doing was excellent. Look how amazing these exhibits look. And the amount of precision she would put into precisely putting these plants there, and it shows the care and passion that comes across at the Royal Botanic Garden in Sydney. And then we look at the research that Lily was doing on looking at those traits and looking at like things on leaf characters, differences in flower shapes and things that we can use to group plants and understand about their evolution and create these databases, not only to help with identification, but to understand the whole evolution of the floral kingdom. It was quite amazing, really.
Yeah, I think that's going to have a really big impact for plant conservation. So we say it's the last episode, but that's only for this season of this year. So we will be back next year with a brand new lineup of content. What are you excited about exploring potentially in those episodes?
Well, you know, we've got three amazing botanic gardens and we're focused mainly on the Royal Botanic Garden Sydney, but introducing some of the audience to these other amazing botanic gardens and some of the cool plants out there, like proteas that are found in the Blue Mountains Botanic Garden, Mount Tama, would be amazing to see.
Yeah, we've only scratched the surface here. So remember, while you're waiting, you can watch some of those previous episodes that we've put out. And make sure you like and subscribe and give us any feedback that you think might help make the show even better for next year.
See you again soon. Thank you.
Thanks.